Welcome to Uncommon Knowledge. I'm Peter Robinson. Victor Davis Hanson, a classicist and historian at the Hoover Institution, Dr. Hanson is the author of many books, including the classic study, A War Like No Other, How the Athenians and Spartans Fought the Peloponnesian War. Dr. Hanson's newest volume, published this very month of October, The Dying Citizen, How Progressive Elites, Tribalism, and Globalization Are Destroying the Idea of America. Victor, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
All right, let's begin with the text for today, the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 22, and an incident that took place 2,000 years ago. St. Paul is testifying in Jerusalem. The crowd reacts so violently that Roman soldiers intervene, and the commander orders Paul flogged. I'm going to pick it up at verse 25. As they stretched him out to flog him, Paul said to the centurion standing there, "Is it legal for you to flog a Roman citizen?" When the centurion heard this, he went to the commander and reported it. The commander went to Paul and asked, "Tell me, are you a Roman citizen?" "Yes, I am," he answered. The commander was alarmed when he realized he had put a Roman citizen in chains. Close quote. The story continues. Paul demands a trial in Rome, and indeed he is taken to Rome, where he is martyred. 2,000 years ago, citizenship meant something so definite, so meaningful, so specific that it commands respect from a common commander hundreds of miles from Rome. How should Americans read that passage today? As a reproach to our own loss of the idea?
With nostalgia.
With nostalgia.
What Paul is talking about is, it's a takeoff on a very famous passage, I think, from Cicero, where he says, any man in the Republic, the late Republic, early Empire, all he had to say was, "Civis Romanus sum," I am a Roman, and there were, the doors were open because of the prestige. And so you can really see what people want and what they're naive about, or they don't care about, or they're lackadaisical. So people are crossing our border. Are we having an outcry? I need to be a citizen. I want to be a citizen. They talk about amnesty, but nobody says amnesty. I want to be a citizen. And so the dividing line from a resident and a citizen, what is it now? It used to be monumental. It was, you can't hold an office unless you're a citizen. I think that's still, that's being under attack. I can't vote unless you can vote in some board elections in Massachusetts and California if you're not a citizen. You cannot qualify for entitlements. That's gone. A citizen has the permission to leave his country and come back at will. But now it's just the opposite. I come into SFO and I don't have a passport. I go into a little room and I'm in trouble. I go fly into Mexico City and I cross the border. I can do it with impunity. So those barriers or divides or whatever term we use have dissipated. They no longer exist.
Today, only a little more than half the world's 7 billion people, I'm quoting from The Dying Citizen, are citizens of fully consensual governments enjoying constitutionally protected freedoms. They're almost all Western. These realities explain why millions from North Africa risk drowning in the Mediterranean to reach Europe, and why millions more uproot from Mexico and Latin America to cross the southern border of the United States. Close quote. Here's the question that raises right away. Is citizenship coincidental, or is it central to the way of functioning that sets the Western world apart? Do you see what I'm saying?
I do.
If a Mexican, let's say a Mexican from some poor mountain town in Oaxaca, what he wants is a better life for himself and his family. He's drawn to the economic engine of the United States. Citizenship is incidental in his mind, but is it incidental to the American project itself?
Well, citizenship is a synonym for a constitutional republic. And it's very rare. It's fragile. It doesn't exist in history very much. It's the aberration. And it's very difficult to make people pick their own leaders, audit them, vote on issues of revenue and taxation, etc. So most people outsource that to monarchs or tyrants or somebody else. But this idea that you're an independent, autonomous, middle-class citizen is very rare. And when you talk to people who come from Mexico, and I do a lot, they say things that nobody would guess. They don't say, "I just came here for better wages." There's a friend of mine, Raul, I won't give his last name. He said, "I came up here because when I was in Oaxaca, no one ever called me senor. It was you or Raul. I came up here, the first thing I noticed when I went into the doctor's office in Selma, California, I'll just use the word Mendez, Mr. Raul Mendez, can I help you?" In other words, a citizen, that he thought he was a citizen, but people were given a modicum of respect. So we want to cherish that. And you cannot have citizenship, as I said in the book, unless you have a sacred space that inculcates traditions and customs.
Borders.
Borders.
And those borders have to be sacred space within borders.
Yeah, that's what, you go to Greece, the wars were over borders because they thought that Thebes and Athens or Argos and Sparta, that they had to have that space, and they were very jealous of it because outside of the space, they didn't have the power. They didn't have the control. They didn't have the money to extend their citizenship. The idea was if you try to extend citizenship beyond your natural confines and you dilute it at the core, sort of like the British Empire,
right.
And then you're writing right at the core at London, you've got Dickens writing David Copperfield. It's rotten at the core.
Right, right. Victor, you divide the book, The Dying Citizen, into two parts. In the first part of the book, you entitle Pre-Citizens, and you describe certain states from which entities, nations, must raise their people before they can achieve real citizenship, and into which various forces are now dragging Americans back.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Could we take a few of those and just take me through them? One of these is, I'm going to call it disappearing self-sufficiency, but I'm going to quote you. The population cannot exercise its rights without material security, that only the economic self-reliance and autonomy of the middle class ensure, close quote. And you illustrate this point by talking about the democracy of ancient Greece, where only those with a certain degree of property, not the very rich, but they had to have some property, were permitted to participate in the assembly. Today, I'm continuing to quote you, today the modern suburban everyman is becoming a nostalgic ideal rather than a vibrant reality. Indeed, the middle class, the American middle class, has lost economic ground for nearly half a century. So explain, during this half a century, by one economist's measure after another, the country's gotten richer.
Yeah.
So you don't mean just, I mean, we all have iPhones that we didn't used to have. So what do you mean? What do you mean by this?
I'm saying that while we have these appurtenances and we can call Nigeria or Moscow, and we couldn't do that with $1 million 30 years ago,
right.
I understand that. But I'm talking about the ability to function within a society in an autonomous fashion. So if you're a young person, mm-hmm. you get your sociology major, and what do? You have $50,000, $60,000, $80,000 in debt. $1.7 trillion in debt. And if you die
in student debt.
Yes, student debt. The average person dies with about a net worth of $10,000. And about $10,000 in credit card debt. So you're not creating people who are going to say to wealthy people, I want to be very careful that these very powerful, influential people do not leverage, warp, massage government action. I'm quoting almost Aristotle now. And you don't want people who are very impoverished to say to the government, I need a subsidy. So you've got these middle people that said, I don't need the government and I don't need wealthy people. I'm an independent person. I'm going to audit my elected officials. I'm going to speak out if I disagree with General Milley, if I don't like Anthony Fauci's policy, I'm going to say so. I'm not worried about the government retaliating to me. I'm not worried about a Mark Zuckerberg or Bill Gates. He can't hurt me. I'm an independent. And yet, what do we have? It's what Tocqueville was brilliant in Democracy in America. He said that basically he forecast what would happen when you had an entitlement state. You'd have a prolonged adolescence. So what are we doing now? If you look at the first age of marriage, 23 to 29, first child, 26 to 30.
Over what period of time?
Over the last 20 years? Over about 50 years. And then buying a house, we were making progress. 63% is going down, and the age is going up. And so we're having these people, I guess Obama knew something that we didn't when he had the Pajama Boy commercial and the Life of Julia, that we were creating dependent people upon government or the largesse of wealthy people. And
an infantilized population.
It was very valuable.
Cell phones does not make for citizens.
They're not independent. And just to finish on the middle class, I was very lucky that I was a classic student because that's central, the mesoi, or central to the experience of civic government and consensual government, and they're mentioned everywhere in classical literature, Roman and Greek literature. But I've also lived in California. And it's a medieval society of rich and poor, with the highest poverty rate in the United States, the most people in the country that are on.
So hang on a second. when you were a boy growing up on the family ranch in Selma, what was California like?
No, it was an agrarian.
I mean, California was wonderful in the 50s, what was it actually like? What
it was an agrarian like? Grid. The average farm size where we lived was about 60 acres. There was a house and a family, and they were in the PTA, they were on the hospital board, they were the Little League coaches, there was
and
a community.
Those 60 acres were theirs.
Yes, and we would say poor people, they were not very wealthy, but they were wealthy in a different sense. They had their own food, they canned them, we dried tomatoes before we had them all winter, we had grape juice, we did everything. And we were outspoken, we didn't care what the wealthy thought of us. We didn't want anything to do with the poor. And there was a natural diversity. There was a Greek-American family, there was a Mexican-American family, there was the Armenian family, there was a Japanese family. No one cared, because they were
because
all
everybody
autonomous.
Had standing, right?
Yeah, and they were all autonomous. And yet, now that same grid, I'm the last person of that neighborhood.
Replaced by?
By very efficient.
Super big ag?
Yes, vast corporate farms, and I rent mine out to a corporate farm. My little 40 acres, and the houses are now rented to very impoverished people. So we're plagued with gangs and crime, and there's no sense of community. And that's California. We've had about 8 to 10 million people leave the state who were middle class. We had an open border where very impoverished, hardworking but impoverished people came under illegal auspices. And then we had the highest concentration of wealth in the history of civilization in Silicon Valley. $5 trillion, a few miles from where we're speaking right now, of market capitalization. And so you can see that it's a coastal elite, and then it's a vast peasantry in the interior and the foothills, Northern California.
The erosion of borders, the dying citizen once again. States must privilege citizens over mere residents, and citizens must live within established borders sharing, here's that marvelous phrase of yours again, must live within established borders sharing a sacred physical space, close quote. The trouble today, again, the dying citizen, we now live in an increasingly borderless world, close quote. Borderless, I get the borderless because you turn on the television and you can see streams of people from the South not being, I don't know what the word, well, they're streaming
2 million
across,
this physical year?
Right, right, streaming across the southern border. But you mean more than that.
Yeah.
You said a moment ago, we can call Nigeria or Moscow on our cell phone. There's some sense of a loss of, part of the problem is tech, no, yes, no, I'm trying to feel my way.
Absolutely,
here.
This has some relevance for the last chapter on globalization. What we were saying is that the communications eroded time and space. So you could go somewhere or you could speak somewhere and there was a uniformity of culture, I get that. But in reaction to that, the physical borders in Europe, but especially in the United States southern border and places in Asia started to collapse. And people got angry because the first thing they discovered is when people migrated across, usually for economic reasons, and they did so en masse, often under illegal auspices, often without capital or skills, then they became wards of the state. And they added to the subsidies that were required to give them parity when enlightened societies, and the taxes burden on the middle class, and wages fell, that were on the middle class wages fell, and crime arose. It's just a fact. And more importantly, when you meet somebody at the barbershop, and you meet somebody, you know, at the hospital, emergency room, and they're not a citizen, and they're not here legally, or they're not even a legal resident, what do you have in common, other than your basic humanity? You say, what did you think of 4th of July this weekend? Who's your favorite president? Are you going to be a Little League coach? And there's a foreignness there. And it's okay if it's a small minority of the population. But when you have 40 to 50 million people that were not born in the United States, some of them are legal residents. Some of them have been naturalized. A lot haven't. Or 27% of the state of California were not born in the United States. Again, some legal residents. Some,
right.
Then you're encountering too many people that don't have the common shared civic reinforcement. And so when you ask them, what do you think of the Electoral College? Or what do you think of getting rid of the 9-person Supreme Court? Or what do you think of outlawing gas lawnmowers in California? Or do you like the 99 being the most dangerous highway in the United States in California? You're met with a blank stare. I don't know anything. Ask me a question about Oaxaca and I can tell you.
Right.
So this, and when you add it finally, Peter, to the host, we're the host, and we used to say, you chose to come in. We didn't ask you. You chose to have a different paradigm from where you left. and we're going to have a brutal bargain. You're going to assimilate you. We're going to integrate you. We're going to intermarry. We're going to make you a perfect American. And if you do this, you have just as much right as somebody who came across on the Mayflower, as Teddy Roosevelt said. Seven generations mean nothing. You are the equal to the daughters of the Revolution.
Right, right.
And now we say, you know, who are we to judge? Who are we to say that our system is better than theirs? Hello, they left. They're theirs. They forsake it. They're here.
They're the ones who said that our system is better than theirs. Victor, there's the economic argument again. I just want to put it to you to see what you hand how, what you do with it. Here's a somebody called Andy Semiotic, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, in Forbes. According to the last census, the U.S. population grew at the second slowest rate over the last decade since the founding of the country. The two main reasons were a declining fertility rate and a reduction in immigration. Our future well-being is intricately linked to increased immigration. A lot more immigration, close quote. Because you need immigrants for economic growth.
Yes. Well, when he says that, I don't want to be untoward, but he uses the word immigration. He
right.
didn't say legal immigration versus illegal immigration. So we have 2 million people coming in this fiscal year illegally. And the first thing they do is violate federal law when they step foot in the United States. The second
Correct.
Thing they do is violate federal law when they reside here. And often, until this administration, the third thing they do is have identification that justifies or protects them when asked, fraudulent Social Security number or driver's license, et cetera. So they conflate the two. Let's just take away illegal immigration
All right.
and look at legal immigration. We take more legal immigrants than any country in the world, unless you say, well, Saudi Arabia has guest workers that go back and forth. So already we are the most liberal country in the world as far as immigration. Everybody knows that. But what people do is, because they have other agendas, whether they're corporate people and want cheap labor, whether they're ethnic groups that want an identity politics base, whether they want to change the electorate for the Electoral College, whether they're Mexico or they want remissions, $60 billion for Central America and Mexico per year from people who are mostly on subsidies in addition to their wages to send back to Mexico.
Right.
Maybe they want a safety valve so revolutionaries go north rather than march on a racist Mexico City. Whatever the reason is, people realize that illegal immigration benefits people, but it does not benefit the citizen, the middle class. Legal immigration does.
All right. One more of these categories of pre-citizenship, tribal identity. The dying citizen, quote, all citizens should give up their own ethnic, racial, and tribal primary identities. Only through such a brutal bargain of assimilation. You come here, you learn English, you learn the way our government works. Correct? That's the kind of assimilation you mean. Only through such a brutal bargain of assimilation can they sustain a common culture. What's wrong today? Again, the dying citizen. Until the late 20th century, the United States suffered only sporadic episodes of blood and soil exclusivity, and instead, usually through intermarriage and assimilation, made the idea of racial or ethnic purity inert. Now the nation is threatening to go tribal. Once a man owes more loyalty to his first cousin than to a fellow citizen, a constitutional republic cannot exist, close quote. Explain that.
Well, there's been very few multiracial societies of any sort in history. The natural bird of a feather flock together is the norm,
right?
As Socrates said. Okay, so when you have a multiracial country and people are naturally tribal, you can use coercion like the Soviet Union did, or the Ottoman Empire, or the Roman Empire. Or you can try to be a democratic consensual country. Or you can do like the Yugoslavia. Remember how that worked out? Or Rwanda? Or you can be consensual like India and Brazil. It doesn't work out that great. We're the only one that's trying it. If you, Peter Robinson, says, right. I love Japan, it's an ally, I want to be a Japanese citizen and rise high and be a political pundit on Japanese TV and run for office,
zero
chance.
Zero.
If I say, I love Mexican people, I do, and I love Mexico, I'm going to go down and be a Mexican citizen and someday be zero chance.
Gringo forever.
Zero. Okay. So this was a unique experiment. Nobody seems to appreciate that. And Martin Luther King Jr. told us that the content of our character was more important than the color of our skin. So here we are, 50 years after the Civil Rights Movement, and we're re-tribalizing with a complete ignorance of where that trajectory leads in history. It leads to blood and soil violence. It leads to incompetency. It leads to the destruction of meritocracy. I had a just...
You just mentioned Martin Luther King Jr. Of course, you're right here that we had only sporadic episodes of blood and soil, but of course we did have Jim Crow.
We did, and we had slavery.
But the argument is that somehow or other, there was a century of delayed assimilation. What is it? How does that fit into your argument about the virtues of this republic, about how we finally come to...
Because it's innate in the Declaration of Independence. All men are created equal. And in the Constitution, there's not a mention of race at all. So you have these European...
So the ideals are latent, and finally
yes.
we live up
well,
to
them. Well, there's... They're Newman. They've just fought the British, and now they've got this country, and they're half of them, not half, but a quarter of them have slaves, and the other people said, you shouldn't have slaves, and they said, we're going to keep our slaves, and then it's a question, do we want to have another war right after this war? And they said, no.
Let's kick that
Okay, so time. Let's do this, but let's work on it. And so they worked on it. They were slow and tardy, but the innate logic of this Constitution is self-criticism and improvement, and we always do that. But now... Speaking as someone who taught 21 years with mostly minority students in classics, I was under the impression that because of economic conditions and innate prejudices, I was going to take Southeast Asian students, Mexican American students, Mexican national, the diaspora of Oklahoma, poor whites, and teach them classics, diction, logic, analysis, English composition. Maybe they could read French and history, literature, and then they were going to have a prep school education at Cal State Fresno, and I was going to send them if they wanted to go to med school, law school, and they would be better prepared, racially blind. And it worked. And then all of a sudden I noticed that some of my students were very, very successful. And guess what? The last 10 years I noticed that they started to trill their R's on their names, or they put a hyphen with an accent mark, or they started to say, as a Chicana, or as a black person. And I said, where did you get that? You're better educated than a guy from Andover. And they said, well, it pays dividends. And so we're making a retrogression to a pre-civilized state of mind.
The second half of the book, Post-Citizens. Yes. Part one, pre-citizens, the state of humanity from which it must be raised in order to enjoy
its natural pre-civilizational
right.
state.
Post-citizens doesn't transcend citizenship except in the minds of the people who
mostly
are themselves
an elite. And as I say, it's mostly an elite.
Right. Okay. So let's take a couple of these, Victor.
Yes.
I want to stipulate that you've written a book, and this is a vidcast. So I'm working really hard to reduce an ox to a bouillon cube here.
You're doing a very good job.
Well, thank you. But people should read the book. The dying citizen. All right. Permanent bureaucracy.
Yes.
The dying citizen, quote, an unelected federal bureaucracy yearly creates more laws and regulations than the House and Senate. The bureaucratic elite. Both of those words are doing a lot of work in that sentence. The bureaucratic elite believes that it can and should preempt any elected official who it deems dangerous, close quote. Preempting elected officials has what to do with ordinary citizens, ordinary middle-class citizens?
I think people from the founding realized when they looked at other paradigms, whether it was the El Escorial of the Spanish Empire or Versailles of the French Empire or the Bourbons or the Kremlin, the Tsarists, that government by nature has people who master its intricacies. They're not elected. So these people were not elected, but even when monarchs come in, they have to rely on these other people.
They need the bureaucrats.
And when you apply that to democracy, it's contradictory to the spirit of a citizen, legislator, or executive, or judge. And so they were very wary of that. The government was pretty small. The federal government basically dealt with tariffs, and it didn't get into civil legislation. So we started to expand. And we expanded on the notion that equality gradually was to its fruition today is now equity. It's not equality of opportunity, it's equality of result. Now, you and I are not born equally. I don't know, you might have better health, worse health. Your IQ is probably higher than mine.
Doubtful, but
I may be
on.
Luckier than you, you may be luckier than I. But if the government says we're going to be equal, then it needs enormous powers of coercion to make you go down and me go up. And so that requires a huge government. And that was what the philosophical tradition warned about. And yet we've got 2 million people in the federal government, and about 40% of Americans work for some sort of government. And it's from the trivial or the everyday, when you're driving down the 99 or I-5 and you see a road construction and there's girders all over the road and there's guys working, you think, I could sue that guy. It's the most dangerous work site. And then you say, Caltrans. I can't sue them. They're the government. But if a private contractor did that, and I'm speaking as a private farmer, right, it's dangerous. So as we know from the Soviet, when government is everything, you have no power of redress. And then second, at the existential level, what is Lois Lerner, IRS Commissioner General Milley, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, John Brennan, John Brennan, CIA. Head of the CIA.
CIA, right.
Let's be fair to all of them. James Clapper, Director of National Intelligence. We can add in, if we want, Andrew McCabe, Acting Deputy FBI, and James Comey. What do they all have in common? They're completely, we'll put in Anthony Fauci because you've had guests that talked about that. They're never responsible for the consequences of their own ideology. So if John Brennan says, well, I lied, I admit that, I didn't tell the truth about the Senate commuters that we in the CIA surveil. All right, yes, there were people who were killed on drone, I misspoke, under oath. Try that with the IRS. Or when James Clapper says, well, the NSA does surveil people, but I gave the least untruthful answer. Or Lois Lerner said, well, we did use political considerations to target these nonprofit groups and delay them before the election of 2012. Or General Milley said, well, you know, I really didn't break the chain of command by interrupting the protocols about nuclear codes. Or violating Article 88 of the Uniform Court of Military Justice by calling my commander-in-chief a Nazi or Hitlerian. It's alleged in Bob Woodward's book. I could go on, but you have this elite that, because they're like an amoeba and they're not accountable, and they're judge, jury, executioner. They're executive, judicial, legislative power.
The rules do not apply to them.
And that's why they make
And they also cannot be voted out of office.
Yeah. I was very naive. I was a classicist and a farmer. And then I learned one day, I think it was at the age of 26, I didn't own the raisin crop that I was growing. The federal government called the Raisin Administrative Committee owned it. And so all of a sudden, the price fell out in 1982, three. I thought, oh, wow, it doesn't make sense to send plant the crop.
Right.
I'll just pack it and send it at farmer's market. And they said, no, you don't. The Raisin Administrative can set aside a reserve tonnage. This year it's 70%. 70% of that crop is ours. You don't own it. We're going to take it and we're going to make cattle feed or throw it away or send it to Europe for free. I said, but you don't own it. You don't own the, yes, you do. And they, you know, it took a 30-year lawsuit for one grower that challenged it. So it's too big, and it's too unaccountable, and it does a lot of things that are very scary. And we're watching it now, whether it's the Pentagon or an intelligence invest. Eisenhower said, beware of the military-industrial complex. Now I think we're going to have to say, beware of the military-industrial intelligence and investigative complex to encompass these bureaucracies.
Globalism. The dying citizen. You cite the widespread belief among elites, quote, that Americans are becoming citizens of the world. An ancient...
A good word in Greek.
An ancient but unworkable idea of cosmopolitanism has reemerged, close quote. An ancient... Yes. Right, so
cosmos,
know,
universe,
yes,
politeis, citizen. Socrates and Diogenes supposedly said it.
Okay.
Supposedly.
But I think of this idea of citizenship of the world, this idea comes to us because air travel is cheap and easy, because it's very easy to communicate with anybody on the face of the planet who's hooked up to the internet. With WhatsApp, it's free to call Europe. I think of this as technology erasing our sense of citizenship, of nationality. But then Victor says this is an ancient idea.
Yes.
Explain.
Well, I think what's happened in the last 30 years, what you talk about, the global inclusivity of cell phones and dish TV, jet travel, has been confused that because we all wear tie-dye t-shirts and flip-flops and jeans, whatever country we're in, or we say, okay, man, or the F word, or you can go to Argentina, or you can go to Taiwan and hear rap music, we're all right in the brotherhood of man. We're not. As I said, 190 nations, as you read, less than half of them are consensual. So if you confuse this harmony that's a veneer, this similarity, and with something existential.
It's only a similarity.
Right. So, I'll give you an example. Where it leads to is Secretary of State Blinken asking the United Nations to investigate whether the United States is racist or not. So basically he's telling Americans, I trust an ecumenical body of nations, 60% of whom are not consensual, and they include China that has 1.4 people in camps. And they may have political reasons to find us racist, but we're going to abide by their recommendations, or the criminal court, or the Paris Climate Accord. It was summed up by Klaus Schwab, the architect of Davos. Remember him?
Right.
Good old Klaus Schwab. I read some of his books. And he wrote a book, The Great Reset. And if we could just get all of the elites together, a Bill Gates on one side of the table, a John Kerry, and we can get them all here, and then we can decide that there should be an international tax code, which they're going to decide.
They did.
And then get rid of that Ireland undercutting everybody to get investment, and we're going to get together, we'll have diversity, we'll set quotas for diversity. We're going to run things. It's just like right out of frightening Plato's Republic with these guardians, you know, they're superior people, and they're going to talk down to people, the elite.
So,
philosopher king.
Victor, mental experiment. Facebook.
Yeah.
2.8 billion users.
Yeah.
So since this country has a population of 330 million, we've got 80-85% of Facebook users are outside this country. Facebook has offices around the world. It pays taxes in one country after another. Why should the people who founded and run Facebook think of it as an American company?
It's not.
All right. So what should we do about Facebook? Anything?
I think we should say, if you have a competitor like Parler, and I have conflict of interest, I know the founder of Parler, and I like her a great deal, but don't try to put her out of business. And we used to treat people like you that were entrepreneurs, brilliant, successful, but mastered or rigged the game. They were called Rockefeller, Carnegie, and we had antitrust laws. So if you say, they're saying to us, Peter, if you don't want to have a Facebook account and you don't like our censorship and you don't like that we rig certain news stories, or Google is saying to us, I think 85% of the searches, and we know that they calibrate the searches on some kind of the results on political people, then go somewhere else. Sort of like saying to an African American in 1950, if you're in Alabama or Mississippi, if you don't like my lunch counter, that's a free country. Go to that other lunch counter. And he says, well, there is no other lunch counter. Oh,
can't,
I didn't
help
know
you
that.
There. Right.
Yeah, well, if you don't like Facebook, go to another. There is none. You've got a monopoly. You bought out 200 companies. And so they're monopolies.
So can I ask then, is your reading of antitrust at the turn of the 20th century, Teddy Roosevelt, great champion of antitrust, and what's going on at some basic level is ordinary middle-class Americans, who at that stage there were still a lot of farmers. Selma was still being farmed in those days. And they look at J.P. Morgan, and they look at John D. Rockefeller, and they look at Andrew Carnegie, and they say, well, I don't know the details, but that's just too big. That's just not American. It's unhealthy.
It's not bigness or size.
It's not.
It's control of the market. By undercutting competitors and forcing them to sell out, or offering them money, or censoring the use of the product according to partisan or political views, or having so much. We used to have this term dark money. Remember Jane Meyer, dark money?
Yes.
What
is
$500 million of Mark Zuckerberg infused in the 2020 election at particular precincts to enhance the registrar or the balloting work of the government?
So is it a test? Will it be a test for you over the next 5 or 10 years if Americans say, more or less coherently, but if there's at least an impulse to say to Facebook and Amazon, YouTube, this we have to control you?
Yeah.
Is that sort of a test?
I think we did that with AT&T. We've done that a lot. Why doesn't Amazon say, you control all of our purchases, you gained $100 billion during the lockdown, just sell off your books or your kitchenware group to another thing. And they don't, you know, we can do that if we want. But we didn't think this up. We love these companies. And then we discovered something, that they manipulate searches, that they manipulate the order of a search, that they let the Taliban tweet, but not the former president of the United States, on Twitter. And so there are active economic, social, and political agendas, and we're not the political one, they are the political one, and they have an agenda, and they're using their power and monopolies for a particular political purpose.
And the correct response is, we're citizens, don't treat us like serfs.
The correct response is, you do your worst and we'll do our best, and may the best man win. We're the citizens, not you. And we'll see who wins.
Okay. Victor, what is to be done? So here's my thinking on reading The Dying Citizen. Education. If we're going to assimilate people, if we're going to teach Americans the importance of citizenship, education. But the people qualified to educate in this country overwhelmingly disagree with you, right? In our colleges and universities.
I'm speaking at a college campus. I'm glad that you used that euphemism. Well, disagree with
me. It's you and me, Victor. It's you and me. So, I mean, that's a special case. What do we make of the declining importance of citizenship to the people who instruct young American citizens?
It's tragic. When we were all in school, we had something called civics.
Yes.
And I remember when I was in first grade, we were taught how to fold the flag and march it. We were taught a whole array. I say we were taught. In my first grade class, there was about 9 who were so-called white and 31 that weren't. And very impoverished, had about a $4,000 per capita income in Selma, California in 1960. But everybody learned these protocols. And then we learned that there was a tripart government, and then our teacher would go, checks and balances. And then we were talked about the crack in the Liberty Bell. And then we were given little bios, and they were not just Lou Gehrig or George, they were George Washington Carver. Yeah. And they were great inventors, Thomas Edison. So there was this inculcation.
No matter how poor, no matter where your parents came from, you were taught to be an American.
If there was an ideological bent to them, it wasn't racism, it wasn't capitalism, it was middle classism. And the idea was, this guy came from nothing. The Wright brothers came from nothing. And that's what it was, the middle class chauvinism, if I could. And that's what we were inculcated in. And then we decided in our infinite wisdom, the more affluent, leisured, and wealthy we are, we were going to make this university. And we said to ourselves, did we in the 60s, the family is racist, it's sexist or classist, and the church and the community and the government. So we in the university are brilliant people, and we can't be fair or disinterested because the whole society is biased. So guess what? We get to be biased. So we're going to take you, and we're not going to give you Socratic inductive education. We're going to deductively tell you that your heritage, your founding, the nature of your country is toxic. It always was, it is, and it always will be unless you listen to us. So it's an indoctrination. And it levers this effort, partly because of globalization on the coast that enriched the coast.
Right.
And that's where the universities are, aren't they? The Ivy League or Stanford or where we are today. Or USC, it's not, I mean, there's great universities in it, but that's not where the power lies. And these globalized people and the wealth, you know, endowment, 30 billion, 40 billion. So they said to us, we're going to indoctrinate you in a very noble way and make you enlightened and better, change human nature. Okay, so they did that. And in the process, people did what? It's a zero-sum game. They didn't learn language. They didn't learn philosophy. They didn't learn physics, math, at the old way. And so they became very confident but very ill-prepared. And arrogance and ignorance are about the most toxic combination you can have. If you also add $1.7 trillion in debt that these universities colluded with the government. And they talk about collusion. $1.7 trillion. So these kids
student debt.
What are they going to do with a BA from Cal State San Jose in sociology when you owe $80,000? You tell me. And the university jacked up the rate of inflation, the rate of tuition above the rate of inflation annually. Mm. Why did they do that?
Victor, China. The billionaire Ray Dalio, quote, empires rise when they are productive, financially sound, earn more than they spend, and increase assets faster than liabilities. This tends to happen when their people are well-educated, work hard, and behave civilly. Compare China with the United States on these measures, and the fundamentals clearly favor China. Close quote.
consensual government with citizenship at the heart of the entire project. Victor, 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 that's yesterday. China is creating an entirely new model, and it works.
Well, I know you're playing devil's advocate, but whether it's Hegel or Nietzsche or Spengler, going back to Tacitus or Spittoni, there's a whole tradition of nihilists. And they warned us. They said that consumer capitalism, consensual government, creates affluence and leisure at untold magnitudes. And therefore, the individual must have religion, family, community, traditions, parents, fear of their grandparents looking at them from heaven or hell, whatever, to restrain the appetites. And when they are loose, and they will inevitably be loose, it's too much of a you get what we have now. If you look at our popular culture.
Decadence. Okay. The word for it is decadence.
The Romans had a word luxus, luxury. But it meant always pejoratively. It was meant. And then China comes along and says, we look at these Western decadent people and look at them. And I just read a Chinese article. They had their pride flag. They had their gender studies at Kabul. They had George Floyd's mural. And what were they doing? They were hightailing it out. And they were different from the British. At least the British imperialists, when they imposed an enlightened culture, won. And their culture is debased. And they're leaving and losing. So that's what the Chinese think of us. And so what I suggest to all of us is that China is a pernicious model. That model that you say is winning has got 1.5 million people in concentration
camps. The
Uyghurs. And it is a racist society, endemically racist. During the COVID breakout, they went and looked at African-American foreign students and began to arrest them to see if they had COVID. And they created myths that came from Africa. And if you're not Han Chinese, you're not going to make it in China. Okay, so they have these ideas, and the way that we are supposed to compete with them, and I mean we have to compete from a symmetrical relationship. So if they're going to steal patents and copyrights and run up big surpluses and dump currency and manipulate the financial markets, okay, we can still beat them if we're better than they are. But what are we doing in these universities? California just passed a rule that said everybody has to learn ethnic studies in high school. Why not just say everybody has to have a knowledge of the English language or analysis or physics or math or biology? So if we're going to have a multiracial society, which we do have, mm-hmm. why don't we make it more educated than China? And when I had students that took classical Greek from all different backgrounds, guess what? I didn't have to teach ethnic studies because everybody forgot who they were. Because it was such a difficult subject, they worked together, they dated, they married. Why don't we do that? Why don't we tell people that are impoverished, that are of Hispanic background or African American, it's my duty as someone who's better off economically to tutor you. And I'm going to give you the skills to beat the Chinese. And aggregately, we're going to beat the Chinese. And I think we could do that easily. And I also think that because it's not a consensual society, that they have a rendezvous with some problems. But I'm not going to say, oh, don't worry about the Chinese. They're a dictatorship. Or don't worry, they're racist, as a lot of people do. No, they're very smart. And they understand the Western mentality better than we do. Mm-hmm. And they are ahead. And we have to catch up. But it doesn't do any good to whine about how they cheat. The question is, don't get mad, get even. And get even with a different approach to education.
Victor, let's close with John Fitzgerald Kennedy speaking in West Berlin in 1963.
2,000 years ago, the proudest boast was, Civis Romanus sum. Today, in the world of freedom, the proudest boast is, Ich bin ein Berliner.
Not quite 6 decades ago, a president of the United States could speak a phrase in Latin, Civis Romanus sum, and take it for granted that his audience would get the reference.
And they did.
And they did. He could speak a second phrase, Ich bin ein Berliner, yeah. I am a Berliner, in the confidence that his audience would understand the concept of citizenship on which that phrase turned. I stand with the people of Berlin, a specific place in time,
bordered. I stand with the nations of the West, actual nations, the United States, the United Kingdom, France, specific bounded places against the globalist challenge of communism. Can we recover the sense of history and citizenship that made that moment 6 decades ago possible?
I hope so. Because if he gave that speech on a university campus, he would be disinvited or deplatformed or canceled because they would say, well, what if you weren't a citizen? Who were the oppressed? So we got to do a couple of things. We have to say that history in the past is not melodrama where you pick winners and losers, bad guys and good guys. It's tragedy. And we in the present don't go back and use our standards and judge these people that were pre-industrial people. They didn't know whether they were going to die the next day from a ruptured appendix. They didn't, if they had far-sighted problem, they couldn't see. They didn't have glasses. We give them no allowances. And we don't ever say to you, Peter, you know, I'm really worried about our culture because 50 years from now, people are going to judge us by their standards. They're going to say a million viable infants were aborted or 7,000 African Americans were butchered in the streets and nobody stopped it. Or there's 700,000 people defecating on sidewalks and nobody stopped. That was what the sum total of us in 2012. Do we want that? And yet, in this arrogance we talked about, this ignorance of history comes a natural arrogance. So we've got to be a lot more humble and we've got to say to ourselves, you don't have to be perfect to be good. And that was a theme in the book. You just have to be better than the alternative. So what Kennedy was saying was that it wasn't perfect in Rome, but there were elements that were better than what was going on the other side of the Danube among Germanic tribes or among the Huns or the Vandals. And we have to say that. This country is better than the alternative, and we're good people, and we don't put the burden of being perfect. And who are we to judge people that were impoverished and died at 35 when we have all the technology on the shoulders of giants, their scientific developments and contributions we were the beneficiaries of, and yet the wealthier and more leisured we are, a future generation is going to say, my God, look at that culture. Where was your Beethoven? Where were your giants? And when you had people that spoke out and were, you know, individual minds, you made fun of them, or you called them racist or sexist or transgender, homophobic. And who are you people to say that? And the answer, of course, is to a little humility, a better educational system, and unity, unity, unity. And that's why in The Dying Citizen, to finish, remember the middle class is the hope for citizenship. Remember that you have to have a sacred space with secure borders. Remember that the road to perdition is tribal affiliation rather than making it incidental, not essential to who we are. And do not trust our elite who say we need unelected, unaccountable bureaucrats who are technocrats and experts that you stupid legislators and voters don't know about. And then be careful about the unelected and the evolutionaries who say, let's change the system because it doesn't benefit us. Get rid of this Supreme Court membership. Get rid of the Electoral College. It didn't hurt. It didn't help me right now. And finally, we're not citizens of the world. We're citizens of a very unique republic that is in itself with no need of input or advice from communist China or Putin's Russia or the European Union. It's a singular, most successful civilization in history, and it's the most humane. And it would be just absolutely suicide to turn over our sovereignty to those who haven't earned it.
Victor Davis Hanson, author of The Dying Citizen. Thank you.
Thank you.
For Uncommon Knowledge, the Hoover Institution, and Fox Nation, I'm Peter Robinson.